Welcome to this video on clouds and climate change. My name is Herman Russenberg. In the previous model, we have seen that clouds influence your energy balance in different ways. They interact with atmospheric radiation and distribute energy via condensation and evaporation. That is, however, not a complete story. We also have to include the role of tiny dust particles, aerosols. We have seen that clouds form after condensation of water vapor in the atmosphere. If you take a parcel of air and water vapor, A in the diagram, and lift it upwards, it will cool down. After a while, it will cross the height where the temperature is low enough for condensation to occur and liquid is formed, position B in the diagram. During the condensation, latent heat is released into the air, which gives additional energy for the partial for more convection. On its way upwards, more condensation occurs and the cloud grows. While this is already a complex process, we have to add one more layer of complexity, aerosols. While the presence of water vapor is the first prerequisite for cloud formation, clouds will not form in nature without aerosols. Why is this? Condensation implies that the bonds between water molecules become stronger. They do not move freely anymore, but are tightly linked to each other. Clusters of water molecules are formed and the bonds between these molecules is strong. In fact, the bonds are that strong that other molecules need a large amount of energy to break these bonds before they can join the cluster. In nature, the molecules do not have enough energy for this and the clusters will not grow that much. Luckily, the atmosphere is full of aerosols. They are much larger than molecules and can attract water vapor in the atmosphere. The distance between the molecules when absorbed by the aerosols is much larger than in the cluster we have seen before, and the binding force therefore much smaller. It is now much easier for other molecules to join in on the aerosol particle, and eventually the aerosol collects so many water molecules that it grows into a mature water droplet. These dust particles act as a catalyzer for droplet formation. So an aerosol is important for the formation of a single droplet. What are the consequences for the formation of a complete cloud? Imagine an atmosphere with a fixed amount of water vapor, and let's also assume three scenarios. There are no aerosols in the atmosphere. If you lift an air parcel above the condensation level, not so much will happen. The condensation is restricted as we have seen before. Now let's inject a few aerosols into the atmosphere and lift the parcel again. The aerosols will enhance the formation of cloud droplets, and since there are not so many aerosols, they can absorb many water molecules and grow into large droplets. If we now increase the number of aerosols, the water vapor will be distributed over more particles, and we will see a cloud with many small droplets. Mind you, in the last scenarios, the clouds contain equal amounts of liquid water. It is only distributed over different numbers of droplets. The influence of clouds, of aerosols on clouds, is important for two fundamental reasons. A cloud with many small droplets reflects more solar radiation than one with fewer but larger droplets. Rainfall forms easier in clouds with large droplets than in one with many small droplets. Or put differently, increasing the number of aerosols can lead to a longer cloud lifetime and therefore longer cooling effect of such clouds. The exact role of clouds and aerosols in the climate system is still part of scientific research. It is one of the least understood aspects. Let's have a look at how different climate models, also called global circulation models, estimate the effect of clouds in a changing climate. We assume that the amount of CO2 is doubled with respect to the values we had before the Industrial Revolution. We compare 12 models and make the contributions of the separate component visible. What do we see? All models agree on the impact of increasing CO2 on the radiation balance. The temperature will increase with some 1.1 degrees Celsius. The models differ, however, how they calculate the response of the Earth system to this warming. We will get more water vapor in the atmosphere, but the models give slightly different values for the additional warming. It varies between 0.5 and 1 degree. The Earth will reflect less solar radiation into the atmosphere, for instance, due to the melting of ice. This will lead to a few tenths of a degree more warming. The climate models differ a lot in how they calculate the response of clouds. While some models say that clouds have no impact at all, others estimate an additional warming of 2 degrees. So there's a lot of uncertainty on how clouds will respond to global warming. But all models seem to agree on one thing. clouds will cool the Earth less than they do now. What are the possible mechanisms for this? More warming can lead to stronger convection in the atmosphere and higher clouds may be formed. As we have seen in the previous model, high clouds trap infrared radiation and warm the Earth. This effect is strongest in the tropics. In a warmer environment, low-level cloud decks may become thinner or even open up, evaporation, and reflect less solar radiation into space. The cooling effect will become smaller. Warmer air at the equator drives the clouds towards the poles, where there's less solar light to reflect. The cooling effect decreases. We have seen that it is quite challenging to understand the role of clouds in the climate system. We have to put the different elements in this plot together. How much aerosols and greenhouse gases do we put into the atmosphere? How does this change the radiation balance? What is the impact of radiation changes on the surface temperature? And how does that affect the evaporation and sensible heat fluxes? How does that affect the formation of clouds and rainfall? And how does that change the radiation balance again? These are quite some questions to ask and answer. How should we address these questions? That can only be done via a combination of modeling and observations. We need the observations from space, ground, and aircraft to understand the current state of the system Earth and to study separate processes. Models are needed to put the observations into the context of general understanding and to make the calculations of what might happen in the future. And then again, we need the observations to test the models.